Obviously, when you get succeed, okay, media started to get also interest, okay. We don't see it clearly here, but 2013 in Slovenia, we had 100,000 TV spectators in our game of broadcast live. 100,000, it's nothing. In 2015, it was, in Montpellier, it was 300,000. And now, in Helsinki, in 5 games, 7.6 million, okay, sold on arenas, and in the best case, 1.6. Okay, doesn't tell you, but maybe you want to remember we have 5 million people in Finland, and we have 20,000 back. Okay, but people are interested about that. So now it's time for us to think and we make it up. What happened? 2006. We made four deep, very important decisions at that time. We were not happy how the clubs were running the practice. We were not happy how they were educating the kids. So we said it's better to have at least one way than no way at all. And for sure, it was a lot of criticism in that beginning. We pick up all the youth national team programs, head coach for the men national team, creating his playing style, which goes with all age groups. wanted to create some kind of identity for Finnish basketball. How Finnish team is played, how we play defense, what are the main principles there, how we play offense. We play, okay, maybe from 1990s, Chicago Bulls have primal offense with coach Jackson, yes, Coach Jackson, and we have similar principles from there, you know, how we start to do. Now, 2018, for sure, when we have more players, a little bit different type of players, there is a little bit of difference between the national team program, but the identity is still there, you know, the same idea of how to play basketball is still there. Aiming higher and demanding more. New licensing system for coaches. It doesn't help, you know, if we don't educate our coaches, if we don't put high standards for them. So not everybody is allowed to coach in certain levels. Like here in Romania, I think this is why you're here also to get the certification, you know, to start make studies with the coaches. But we put a lot of pressure since 2006 and a lot of education. On coaches. All the youth national teams have full-time coaches. They are working there. There's nobody who's with the youth national team who's not a full-time coach, okay? These stats that they build have to be so that we find jobs for them, okay? We get some funding from the Olympic Committee to place them in the clubs in the beginning to get the clubs also involved. But right now, I will tell you later how it works. Significant increase for the number of the days we will have the kids under our national team program and the games. I just calculated because I was working for the Federation before I came here. Our 160 national team 2017, the program was 60 something days together, camps and tournaments during the year. Unfortunately, they have to pay for it. There's a maximum number for one player, he has to pay is 1,200 euros per year to be involved in 60 days basketball. For sure, there's families who will have, and we will have a backup plan for that. They can have apply for a stipend, and there's nobody left. Outside the program, if you're willing to take part, but we don't have that money for give it free for the kids. On the other hand, we are not practicing in gyms like this. We are practicing in a sport institute, you know, where it's great facilities for also for our youth national team programs. There's everything there. There's nutrition. There's great gym, there's weight rooms, everything, you know, what it needs to be seen as a professional level. So we changed that one also. This is the road to the adult national team. Basically, we are getting them into our hands age of 15, not early, but at this moment, we are also controlling a little bit about this, is it upper school? Upper school, do you understand what I say? Upper school, age of 12 to 15. We have coaches to go there, you know, with the clubs and to control a little bit about the talents. We have this talent foster program where we, from these 20,000, we can't lose a single one. We need to know, you know, who's good and who's not. We need to know, we can't just leave them alone, and this is one of the things, you know, I think maybe it is succeeding better in the last decade. About the coaches education. Okay, this is the mission where we started, okay? Higher quality coaches, better players, okay? Understanding how to teach the kids. will for sure, you know, help the kids getting better. We are number one or two country in the world in the school system. If you go with this PISA analysis, you know, what they calculate about the learning results in the world. We also see that our strength in coaching, you know, that we know how to teach, and we want to involve this teaching part into our coaching education. Because coaching is teaching. You need to know how to teach kids. You need to know how to teach a little bit older guys, or girls. You need to know about them. Every person learns different way. You learn different than I do. And if I don't understand this, how can I teach these kids? You know, first I need to know about them, understand, and then somebody learns watching, somebody learns listening, somebody learns reading, somebody from video, somebody from scouting, so on. So we are all different learners. So this was one of the biggest things, you know, that we involved this teaching part in our coaching and education. How to get the guy learn. So the idea of the education is to help the coach so that the coach has the tools to help the player. So this is for sure the biggest thing, you know, what has changed this whole thing, you know, our coach's education and it comes to three, four guys, you know, we're very determined to develop this program. Okay, this is about the training, how to do it. So, to coach a kid, coach a player, it's about four things, you know. Okay, now we were talking here about how they can solve game situations, how they can have techniques and everything, you know, to be successful on the court. So, to have the tools to play. That's first, to know about these techniques and tactics. Then it comes also to the physical abilities. We don't have these players. We don't. We're a small country. It's very, very rare, you know, if we have a bigger than 205. Okay, now we have one guy, 213, who's in NBA. That's very rare for us, okay? But we need to also know about these physical abilities, you know. What are the standards in the top level? How strong you need to be, how fast you need to be, how good endurance you need to have if you want to compete in EuroLeague, if you want to compete in the NBA. We were lucky because our head coach, Henrik Denmark, coached German national team in 2002 World Championship with Dirk Nowitzki. And we used them, we were allowed to use the test results from that national team. And that told us, you know, at some level, that if you want to compete in a world championship, these are the numbers of German national team players. Right? This is the interior step, you know, what they did. And this is the number what they had, you know, for the guard. You need to be able to run this attack, okay? This is how strong they are. And this is how we started to think, you know, this is the level we need to catch if we want to compete and when we want to compete in the top. And you need to have the knowledge first. Otherwise, you just think that this is the level. And biggest change after these three other things has been done. Okay, we learn how to teach the kids. We learn to understand what is the level they need to be as a skill wise and also with the strength. Is that they started to win. They started to win. And I was a kid, you know, we could play Estonia, we didn't for sure. We didn't even dream to play Russia. Now our under-17 was in the World Championship 2 years ago. They beating Serbia 3 years in a row. So when we got there, coming to the men's level, the women's level, they know, okay, these are the same guys. We beat them 3 years ago, 4 years ago. So the mentality has also changed. Croatia. We haven't been Croatia or Slovenia. At anything. It's been one of the things, you know, very tough clubs somehow. Okay, they will have the promise to go to the place, but we haven't been. So don't understand. Your guys beat Croatia. Whoever will play, they got us, you know, encouragement and promising result. Then I talk about this license. This is the what we have. You have a different here. Basic education done low. B license, A license. You got group coach. It's too complicated to explain. Maybe for everything, but this there's also from I'm a former player. There's different program for those who want to take it all a little bit quicker. Level, okay, different education, but this is what is demanded that you can coach. And when we go to this A license, you don't get you can't go there to get your A license like just to go. There's an exam that you will be have to do first in order to get into that program. There's maybe 60 applications for last year, 15 of them were selected. So we try to keep the level also for this A license, who are allowed to coach in a certain level, it needs to be high. And this is something, you know, which gives us a lot of criticism. There are coaches who are willing to go in 2 years after the coach there. No, no, need to study first, need to, you know, get the exam. And this is something they are not very, very happy. Okay. You have to pay the price also. Not everybody is equal to pay. I think, generally, as I said, this is the biggest thing that we raise the coaching level. It's why we are raising also basketball level. Hey, if you want to comment or stop or ask something, just go ahead. This is the license system. It started 2012. So the A license was this one where you have to apply in order to test and then you have to do your education and then you get the A license level. First you do the B license and so on. For the men's top league, it has to be in 2012 and then for the second league. And now in 2016, see that the four major leagues have to have an A license, otherwise you're not allowed to coach. Now we are talking that can we go also under 19, you have A license coaches over there, but as I said, you know, it's some people don't like the system, so there's a little fight going on. Okay, let me go back to this. So, but the biggest, besides of the coaching, the biggest thing was to invent this green line there from 15 to 19 years old. It's HBA. There's a lot of HBA. That's the basketball I got. And another thing, we will take the best players in 15 and we will come for it. So, if you have a player on the first team, yeah. But we have a, like, year round, what is the problem? Same here?
No,
we don't have to. this is easier because we have a lot of players inside the Brazilian field. This is this school in Brazil. So for them it's easy. But like for Lau, he's coming from San Diego, 400 kilometers away from Helsinki. It meant that he needed to move to Helsinki at the age of 15. Then one of the things that we go in the first. Second year, we made we organized a apartment where I met a job for mother, and they moved to mother. Next 3 years, we will have new facilities, two new basketball fields inside the program. We will have a dorm for the students. You know, we have a place where they can stay. We have two food for three food per day, you know, for free for them. So this is something we are building. Like I said, when you have 20,000 players, you know, you can't lose anything to keep it down. And of course, it's a set, major setback for the clubs, because they will not have it yet. And at the club, also, you know, it hurts, thinking that two of your best players will be in the next year. It's not easy, you know, but if you're thinking, you know, the best interest of the players will be around.
But coach, I have a question. Even though I'm not at the coach.
You can do it.
If you have, okay, you have the kids, they are in clubs, and they have to come to the federation program, okay? The federation chooses one from one club. What happens? They just say to the club, okay, you have to give me that kid. So long, see you next year. Like that happens?
Of course, it's not like that black and white. It's not like that black and white, okay? We are not going to the club, okay? The club don't own the player.
Of course.
And we can't make any contract with the players when they are in 14 or 15. We talk to the parents. If the parents don't, you know, want to do it, we can't take the kid out of the home or out of the club for sure. But right now, like I said, you know, the results, what they have seen here, is that everybody's willing to come. And at some point I would say that the criticism from the club is going also a little bit down, because they all see that basketball is rising, you know, in the last 5 years. It gives them, you know, also more money, more everything, you know, to do these things. So at least right now they have a little peace. But I don't know how long. But so this is the sport crew. They it's high school event in 1967. They started the sport program in 1986, and there's different sports available there. But 2012 we started this HBA program. There's for the, like I said, 50 kids for the boys, 3 full-time professional basketball coaches, 1 full-time condition coach, 2 physios for both. Women and boys team, girls team, and one strict title. And okay, this strict coach was all school, but this is we invest in these coaches. We are paying the coaches, and the school is doing everything else. They are really part of this. And
A lot of everything